أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على مولانا نبي أبدا سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا ومولانا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه إلى يوم الدين فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهادي هدي محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم وشار الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد My dear brothers and sisters in Islam Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh Welcome to the House of Dua and welcome to this special edition My dear brothers and sisters in Islam I've come to you today with a heavy heart with a deep reflection about the damages the coronavirus has inflicted upon mankind, including us as Muslims, the damages that the coronavirus has done and is still doing towards our faith, especially our way of life. My dear brothers in Islam, I don't know if you have found time to ponder about this. Whatever happens to us in life as believers, we are expected to sit down and ponder about it so that we can derive some useful lessons, so that we can be able to move forward. In Surah Al-Imran, verse 191, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala graciously declared, "Ba'da'uzu billahi minash shaitani rajim." بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن في خلق السماوات والأرض واختلاف الليل والنهار لآيات لأولي الألباب الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون وَيَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا سُبْحَانَكَ فَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ My dear brothers in Islam, in these two verses, verses 191 to 192 of Surah Al-Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, In the creation of the heavens and the earth and the alternation between night and day that we see frequently, there are signs, powerful signs and lessons and evidences and revelations for those who have understanding. Those who stand up or sit down or lie down worshiping Allah and those who find time to ponder about the creation, to have deep reflection about things that are happening around them. Those who declare, Ya Allah, you have not created this for nothing. Whatever happens, that is our response. Because we believe that nothing happens in the planet except it's by the command of Allah. And so we declare, Ma khalaqta hadha batilan. You have not created this for nothing, Ya Allah. You have created it for us to learn some lessons. But, fakina azabana. Therefore, save us from hellfire. Save us from the punishment associated with what we have seen. In the context of the coronavirus, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this makes sense. What is going on now could not have happened without the permission and authorization of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, the sustainer, the provider, the one who is in absolute control of our lives, the one to whom we shall return for accountability. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, you know as I know, that since the outbreak of this disease, known as the coronavirus, our lifestyle in the world has been altered. So many people have been affected. More than 15 million people have tested positive to coronavirus across the world, out of which about 700,000 have already passed away. Millions of others are in hospital, striving to recover. And of course, millions of others have been discharged from the hospital, but then they are contending seriously with the side effects of this pandemic. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we as believers, just as others in the society, we are not excluded. Especially our way of worship has been drastically altered or impacted upon by this terrible disease. Have you had time to think about it? Do you reflect about it? And if so, what do you think? My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we are in uncharted waters. We are facing a very serious problem. And unfortunately, mankind is dealing with this problem with strategies that were used to deal with other pandemics of the past. But they don't know that this is new, this is novel, this is completely unknown to mankind. We are not surprised, therefore, that in spite of the measures that have been taken, we are still where we are. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, when is it going to come to an end? We have no idea. This is why it's important for us as believers to have deep reflection, to think about it, and to be part of the discussion to bring this pandemic to an end. And dear brothers and sisters in Islam, yes, we are very serious with our deen, but then situation has been made difficult for us to practice our faith as a result of the outbreak of the coronavirus. You know, as I know, that this disease does not spare anybody, man or woman, rich or poor, Muslim or non-Muslim. But then, the impact it has on people, especially with regard to the measures taken to combat it, is relative. It affects others more than some. Can there be a universal approach to solving this problem? Allahu alam. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, these are moments that call for concern. And this is why I have decided to come to you today. If you take a look at what has been going on, you will find that some of these measures, as I said, are more severe on some people, on some organizations than others. As far as we are concerned as Muslims, it has had a terrible impact on our way of life. Unfortunately, however, you know, there is no much outcry from us as believers. We are not able to raise these problems, especially our leaders are seemingly quiet. Let's look at some of the measures that have been taken to combat the coronavirus. We have been told to wear a mask all the time, which is good. We have been told to social distance from one another, which is equally good. We have been told to sanitize. We have been told to limit our movements. All these are good, but what are the impact of these measures on our faith? The first casualty of the coronavirus on our faith was our daily gathering to observe our daily salawat, the Jama'a Salat. For a very long time now, that has become almost unattainable, except in few cases. Then came the Jumu'ah. Many days of Jumu'ah have come to pass without Salat with Jumu'ah. Just because we are not able to congregate as we used to do in the past. Then came fasting in the month of Ramadan. The Taraweeh that we love so much, we were not able to do it the way we used to. And the Khatmul Quran that used to be a very big privilege for us during the month of Ramadan. Many of us missed out this year as a result of that, as a result of the coronavirus. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, what about the Eid al-Fitr? Same thing happened. We could barely observe our Eid al-Fitr. Those have passed and gone. What about now? The Eid al-Adha is around the corner. the Hajj has already begun. And now, we are told that unless you live in Saudi Arabia, you will not be allowed to come for the Hajj this year. My dear brothers and sisters, have you taken a look at what is happening at the Kaaba right now? Or the Masjid Nabawi in Medina? Do you see anybody there? And if you see, do you see how they stand? Distant from one another? Is that how it's supposed to be in Islam? Are we afraid of the coronavirus more than the command of Allah and the example of the Holy Prophet Muhammad? Sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers and sisters, not only does the coronavirus affect all these major events that we are used to, what about the content of our worship? Take a look at the content of our worship. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah As-Saff, Inna la yuhibbu alladhina yuqatiluna fi sabilihi saffan ka'annahum bunyanun marsus. Allah loves those who struggle in his way. And they struggle united like a wall that is not broken. They stand straight in a row like an unbroken wall. This has, you know, the context of this verse is the context of our worship especially. This is why we are required to stay, you know, on a straight line, feet to feet, shoulder to shoulder. In another surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Hafizu ala salawat wa salatil wusta wa kumu lillahi qanitin. Observe your salawat, especially your middle salat. And make sure when you pray, you stand firmly and quietly and calmly. How is this possible nowadays, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam? According to the hadith narrated by Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Talib, radiallahu anhu, he stated that Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam informed them one day that when a believer prays, seven parts of his body, including the nose, must touch the ground. Allahu Akbar Kabir. Abdullah ibn Abbas, the son of Al-Abbas, confirmed the same hadith that one day the Prophet ordered them to make sure they pray properly, and when they want to pray, they must make sure that seven parts of their body, including the forehead and the nose, must touch the ground. And the best way for these parts of the body to touch the ground is not to have a barrier between the ground and the physical body parts themselves. Nowadays, we are being told to wear the mask while you are praying, and that mask will not allow your nose to touch the ground, unfortunately. Have we considered the implication of this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam? We are told from time to time to stand up for prayer, feet to feet, shoulder to shoulder. This is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Now we have been told to social distance, even in the masjid, 6 feet apart. And from the various hadith narrated by several sahabas, including Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, and Umar ibn Bashir radiallahu anhu, it was clearly stated that the Prophet sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam at different points in time regularly, you know, commanded or ordered the followers behind him in worship to maintain feet to feet, shoulder to shoulder. This is a prophetic tradition that we cannot be forced to abandon midway in the light of what is happening in today's world. It's part of the meritorious service in our worship. When you say assalamu alaikum, you turn your head to the right and your head to the left, giving salam to the person on your right hand side and on your left hand side. And some of the hadith says you can only do so to the left hand side if there's somebody sitting there with you and touching you. But somebody who is staying 6 feet apart from you, does he qualify for that? These are some of the minor alterations that we are seeing, and we are taking them lightly. My dear brothers and sisters, We have been in a tradition in which when we finish our salat, we exchange greetings. Assalamu alaikum. And in some cases, we have handshake. Though these are not part of sunnah or faraid, but then they add beauty. They are part of the meritorious service of our worship. Nowadays, they are becoming things of the past. Are you worried, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam? Just as I do. The Hajj is here, as I said. It's not like the Hajj we are used to. We cannot find people in the Kaaba as we used to see. The highest gathering mankind will ever think of. We may not see such gathering in the Arafat this year. And you are not bothered by what is going on around us. I am bothered. I am worried. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, do you know why it is like this? It's not because the coronavirus is killing us. It's because the measures being taken by those who are non-Muslims are being swallowed hook, line, and sinker by those who are Muslims, not wanting to make those measures Islam-friendly or at least Sharia-compatible. That's why it's like this. Otherwise, there are ways by which we can adjust these measures and still be able to observe our worship and still be able to come out safe. Are you doubting that? Don't doubt it. Take a look at what businesses are doing, the shopping centers. Take a look at what the sporting centers are doing. They are being innovative. They are coming up with new ideas to adjust their businesses to the demands of the time, the challenges of the coronavirus. What are we doing as Muslims? We are folding our hands. We are simply dancing to the tune. Instead of finding a way to make these measures Sharia compliant, Islam friendly. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, I come to you today to remind you that we are having a big challenge in our hand. Those of us who have not been frequent at the masjid or who are not bringing their salawat as and when due will not find anything wrong in this. Some are even celebrating. Some are thanking God that we are not able to gather anymore. Among us as believers, unfortunately. But we are not all like that. That's why we must speak out to demand what is best for Islam. We therefore use this opportunity to call on our leaders to take a look at the measures that have been adopted to fight coronavirus, to see how far they can make them Sharia compliant. So that we can still put our heads on the ground and the nose touching the ground without, you know, necessarily being made to feel that that is the end of our lives. No, if it comes to death, we as Muslims, we love life and we love death, especially if that death takes place in the service of our Creator. We're not afraid of death, but then we're not calling for it. That's why we must take adequate measures to make sure that we are able to carry out our duties that we owe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a manner that He deserves. And we are also able to, you know, make sure there is safety for our lives. Accordingly, therefore, we are suggesting joining those who are saying, you know what, we need to resume our normal lives. But with great precaution. We are not just saying it for the fun of it. No, we have to say it because of what we are losing as far as our worship is concerned. Yes, we have respect for wearing the mask. We have respect for social distancing. We have respect for, you know, limited movement. All this can still be upheld within our places of worship. And still, we'll be able to go in and worship in Jama'ah and observe the rules of worship and go back home satisfied that we have served our Creator. We want to recommend, therefore, that in addition to all these measures, our various massages need to, you know, come up with new ideas that will help us to come to the masjid in larger number than we are doing now and observe the Salat in the best way so that we can all go home safe. For example, when it comes to Salatul Jumu'ah, we used to observe our Salatul Jumu'ah for a time period of 30 minutes or more. What about 10 minutes or 15 minutes? The shorter the khutbah, the better. That's the tradition of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. Yes, come to the masjid with your mask. Come to the masjid, you know, sanitized. Come to the masjid and still, you know, we'll be able to observe our salawat as fast as possible and go out without endangering any person. 10 minutes is enough to observe any of our salawat, even if it's Salatul Jummah. In addition to that, we need to make sure that every masjid is, you know, sanitized after each salat, so that those who are coming for the next salat will be safe enough to pray. What about making sure that we encourage our worshippers to make sure they do that Nawafil Salat at home? The masjid is no longer the area for that now. And at tomorrow far, by the tradition of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, Sunnah Salat are more rewardable when they are done at home than in the masjid. Many people used to come to the masjid before to lie down or to loaf around or engage in other businesses. All those have to stop. If we concentrate on the worship alone and set time limits and take all other precautions that have been recommended by the professionals and the medical and the scientific community, then of course, we'll be able to observe our worship and go back home safe. As I've pointed out in the past, this is a novel challenge. This is a new thing. It couldn't have come into existence without the knowledge and approval of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ma aswaba min musibatin fin aradi wa la fi anfusikum illa fi kitabin min qabli an nabraha inna zalika ala allahi yaseer. Nothing happens in the planet, not even an adversity touches any of you or a calamity or falls upon you, except that is known to Allah. It's already in His record and is permitted by Him to take place. And that is so easy for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Aren't you surprised that in spite of all these measures that have been taken so far, people are still dying? And people will continue to die. Those who are destined to survive it will survive it. From the point of view of Islam, we must conclude that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows about this. He has his final solution to it. And as I have stated in the past, it's either he's going to blow it away with kun fayakun by his command, as he had done in the past. When the plague took place in the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, there was no vaccine. When there were adversities in the time of Musa alayhi salam, there were no vaccines, there were no special measures. What did they do? They cried to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unfortunately, we are being told nowadays that religion has no role to play in what we are doing. And our scholars are silent to that effect as well. But we beg to differ from this angle. That indeed, this is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to exclude us from the masajid, places of worship, where we ought to turn to Allah and pray to Him and ask Him to remove this adversity, to exclude us from there, it's in fact a misdirection. Every measure needs to be taken to allow those who believe in God to go back to their places of worship, including us as Muslims and other religions. Let all of us join hands together to call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask for forgiveness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, We have said this time and time again. When the people find themselves in an awkward position, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that could be a test from Him, and He will not change that awkward position unless the people change the circumstances that led them into it, their intransigence, their sinfulness, their misbehavior. Are you telling me that there are no sufficient intransigence, misbehavior, and sinfulness that have taken place in the past 20 years? That led us to where we are now. I don't want to go back to recounting all that. We have to move forward to find the solution. And part of the solution is crying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking those who know how to call out to Him, asking for forgiveness. Just as we are taking our human measures, such as wearing a mask, social distancing, limiting your movement, sanitizing, so that all our effort collective will help to defeat this virus. Nobody wants to be sick. Nobody wants to die. But we must not sacrifice our religion, our faith, our belief on the altar of fighting the disease. As I said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Kullu nafsin za'iqatul maut. Every soul, every living creature must taste that delicious food known as death. Either through coronavirus, or through cancer, or through diabetes, or through no sickness at all. Therefore, let us try and do what is right. Let's not take advantage of the coronavirus to suppress the religion. Let's have a united forum to fight this common enemy. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive mankind. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to come to our help, to forgive us and shorten the lifespan of this disease. As I said in the past, there are two ways out of it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may just by his power ask this disease to disappear to a different planet, or he may, out of his mercy, bring down the knowledge through men and women amongst us who will discover the vaccine by which we can bring this pandemic to an end. Whichever way, Ya Allah, we call on you to have mercy on mankind. Ya Allah, see us. You see us every day, and you know what is happening at the Kaaba. You know what is happening at the Masjid Nabawi. You know what is happening at our various masajid, local or international. You know what is happening to our worship. We are not comfortable the way things are now, but we know that you have a big promise for us. That in a situation like this, yes, you know what is going on, and the solution will come. And at the end of it all, those of us who believe in you, to continue to remain in that belief in you, we have a great reward in this world and in the hereafter. Ya Allah, we call on you, therefore, to help us bring this problem to an end in the shortest possible time. Tabana tabami na inaka anta semiyoni ali, otubo ale na ya maula na inaka anta ngefuru kani. Rabbi, yesri wala to us, but may be khairi wabika nastayin. Tabana atina afiduni ya hasan, Wafin akhirati hasan wakina azabana la hawla wala quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyil azim subhana allahi wa bihamdihi subhanaka allahumma wa bihamdika nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk alhamdulillah